Well, this is my very first time driving in this kind of a Porsche.
Ooh, I've test driven a Porsche before.
You did?
So it's fun.
Did you? Let me ask you this. because of what you did for a living as a younger person, being a gymnast and you're like flipping around and you have no fear, do you feel like you have no fear in other areas of your life too, like cars and roller coasters and rides?
I think it definitely gives me a little bit of encouragement because I've flipped through the air and, have overcome that adversity of just, spatial awareness and all of that. So I do think that I am a bit more gutsy and courageous. Like, I would totally love to just floor it if I could and just go. They used to call me Leadfoot when I got my license, but I have toned that down a little bit.
Now that you have children.
I had a little Mercedes, SL500 for a little while. Oh my gosh, it was just a two-door convertible. Oh. I was in Houston, Texas, like loving life, thinking I was so cool. And then, a couple times I was like, I better slow it down.
Do your kids like roller coasters and rides? Because I know they're little gymnasts themselves.
Yes, they do. Carmen is such a thrill seeker. She loves it. Vincent loves it too, but there are sometimes, he's a little bit like tentative, but then when he goes in, he goes all the way and he goes for it. But they love roller coasters just like mom and dad do.
Well, I feel like it's all in the family too, because you have two little athletes in your home. First of all, they're built like gymnasts. Of course they would be, because you and your husband Mike obviously are elite athletes. But then you've got Carmen, who seems like she has exactly your body type, right?
She does. It's funny, our friends that come over and they were gymnasts too, and they're like, oh my gosh, her calves look like yours. She's like a little you with her little body and her strong thighs, and she's just very, very strong.
And then Vincent, I think he seems like he just wants to be even better.
He does.
He wants to be the best one in the family.
Oh, yeah. He's told me. He's like, I want to win more medals than you. I was like, all right. One is hard enough, but sure, you can do it. If you want to work that hard. I mean, it's all up to you, because that kind of work, to achieve that kind of success, requires a ton of dedication, a ton of sacrifice. If you want to be the best in the world, which he's already said he wants to be, for a 7-year-old, that's pretty impressive, I would say.
I would say so too.
You never expect it, from your children to absolutely want to follow in the same footsteps. But he was drawn to it. He loves it. He drives it. He really wants to be great. And it'll be interesting to see how things shake out for him. But I absolutely believe that he has the whole package. He can be anything he wants to be in this sport. He can go all the way. But he's also really smart academically. He also is a great student. So, he can do really anything he wishes to. And I do believe, if he dreams it and he works hard enough, he can accomplish it. So we're just kind of along for the ride to nurture, to guide, to protect, as parents need to when your child has those big dreams. But it'll be exciting to see it all unfold. It's a little, interesting for me as a parent now to kind of, have so much more knowledge than my own parents did. And I don't blame my parents for some of the things that maybe they didn't know about. I mean, how many parents really get a handbook to training an Olympian or training an Olympic champion? You don't know.
Because would you say that your parents, do they really push you? Or was there a lot of pressure from your parents? What would you say their approach was in, training you and wanting the best for you?
I now realize how much my parents did everything in their power to allow me to be my best. Was my dad harsh on me at times? Absolutely. Did he overdo it? Absolutely. There were times where he needed to take a step back and needed to allow me the understanding that he appreciated me whether I won or not. Not only if I won or I did great, everybody was happy, but when I faltered or had an error, it was the end of the world. And it was too much pressure. And it was too much pressure in the sense that I was afraid of him in that way. It wasn't the pressure of the gymnastics that bothered me at all. There were just times that I was afraid of making a mistake for fear he was going to yell at me or enforce some physical punishment to say, oh, you didn't work hard enough. And that's where there was a misunderstanding because of the way he grew up. He thought those kinds of threats would, you know, help make you stronger, tougher, better. But to me, it demoralized me. It made me afraid to make a mistake. And you cannot go into competition with that in your mindset. And it really, when I look back, it's amazing to see how the heck did I do it with that kind of fear at times. But it's because I loved the sport. And I when I got out there, I was me. I was free. And so I was somehow able to, like, forget about all that in the moment when I was competing, because you have to be engaged in the equipment so you don't get hurt. You have to focus. And I was able to have an ultimate focus, that laser focus that helped me get through the competitions. And yes, there were times I really did enjoy myself. I loved it. I loved competing. I loved being the best. That's what drove me. But that other side is what I think my relationship with my father could have been so much better, even in our entire family, if he just would have controlled his temper. Not let it get, you know, so boiled up to be such a big deal if I made an error. Because really, in the grand scheme of life, you know,
we all make mistakes. We're human beings.
How many people do you know leave home at 17 in the way that I did? You know, that was scary.
Do you, looking back now, regret that? Or would you still do that exactly the same way, knowing what you know today?
Oh my goodness, you know, that's something that I've thought about. I would still do it. I wish it didn't happen in that particular way. If I could have changed the blow up that my father had at my coach in the gym that caused kind of everything to spiral out of control, I would just have told my dad, like, we need to sit down and have a conversation. I would have liked that, but because there had been so much fear built between us that I was so afraid of him, like, I didn't want to talk to him either. And because he just wanted to kind of control every aspect of my life. Now, I understand.
Kind of what was happening at the time, too. Because I remember you really were very honest and vulnerable and open about that story in your book, Off Balance. I mean, that's where you write a lot about it.
Yes.
But at the time, the precipice for that was that he let your coaches go, a coach that you really
liked?
He had
fired my coach that had been with me that entire 1998 season that helped me get back to win, you know, arguably one of my greatest competitions of all time, the Goodwill Games. And it got me to a point where I was finally back on my feet again in gymnastics, and I was really proud of that, and I didn't want to change again. I'd gone through so many coaches since 96 to 98. In 2 years, I'd gone through so many different coaches, and it was a lot of ups and downs. And with each coach, there's a learning curve, there's an emotional give and take, there's a, you know, learning about each other's styles. It didn't always work out, you know what I mean? And coming from the high that I came from the Olympic, and obviously the Olympic Games and achieving that gold medal, there were a lot of things that factored into this up and down roller coaster of coaches. It was my coaches, you know, retired at the time, and I didn't have anyone to kind of take that place, and it was just a lot of turmoil, I felt like, in the coaching department. So once I finally got someone that I felt got me, and, you know, it was a really different kind of training approach that we did. I didn't always like her, but we did get results, and that was good. But she was causing some issues between my family, and there was a lot of this back drama that I didn't know about at the time. But my father finally said I'd had enough. I mean, they brought her from Romania, paid for her visa, paid for her to stay here for free. I mean, she kept wanting more and more. My dad's like, you're in America for your first year. You have a house, you have a car, you have a place to stay, you have a salary. He's like, I can only give you so much. We paid $10,000 for you to just come here. We paid for everything. So my father felt like, wait a second, you're asking for too much. I didn't know all that stuff at the time, but then he fired her and said, fine, go back to Romania if you don't want to be here. You know, he had gotten fed up with her, and so then the blow-up happened in the gym one morning where he said, you're fired. And I'm sitting there like, I'm just like emotional because I'm 17, and I don't want to go through the change again. I finally, these past, you know, 8 months, 8 to 10 months, I got back on my feet again in gymnastics. Imagine if I had that stability all the way through. I could have done way more stuff. I had reached my breaking point. He had reached his breaking point, and my coach had reached her breaking point. And when he fired her, I just could not handle going through everything all over again. So I said, you know what? I'm out of here. I am leaving. I never planned it. Obviously, I didn't have anything packed. I just grabbed whatever I could in a suitcase, and I left. And it was scary. I mean, I didn't know where to go. For I didn't have a plan. I didn't want to leave my sister and my mom. And it was one of the most terrifying times of my life. I was so scared of what I was going to do. And then I was scared that, oh my gosh, you know, I left home. My dad is going to try to come and get me. And he's going to be furious with me. And then I'm going to get it, you know. But I was like, there's no turning back. To be at that point in my life, I was a good kid, but to be at that point in my life, I had to have been pushed so far, and I was. And that's the thing, I was at my breaking point. I never, ever encourage any 17-year-old to do anything like that. But I needed to have the control of my life, and I felt like I couldn't have any say in my life. And I was 17, I was on the eve of 18, I was gonna be 18 soon, so I filed for emancipation. And I wish I could have done it maybe a little differently. Like, I wouldn't have, you know, gone and basically ran away from home. I would have done it on a, you know, on a level where my father would have agreed, but he would never have agreed. That's the thing. I knew he would never have given me that allowance had I not, you know, done this step. I had to basically take that freedom and take my life in the sense of financially. Take that from my father and say, look, I am mature enough. I can do this. I would love for you to be willing to participate and willing to sign things over to me, but you're not doing that, so I have to take you to court and make this a drawn-out thing when all you had to do was sign the papers. He was so afraid that people would take advantage of me, and he was right to think that. There were a lot of people. I mean, the first attorney that signed on, you know, charged me $10,000 in a week, and he did all these TV promotions. Yeah. He was like, doing TV interviews, and I'm like, whoa, wait a second. Then I got a good guy, you know, that came in and took over, and he's been with me ever since to this day. So yeah, he's my accountant. But, you know, he was right to think of the people taking advantage of me. But, you know, my Aunt Janice kept telling him, she's gonna be 18 next year anyway. You've gotta, you know, my mom finally was stepping in, and also like, look, you're gonna lose her anyway if you don't sign these papers. So that's what the whole court battle ended up being about, is me just gaining that trust and that freedom to make my decisions and give me that allowance. Do I wish it, you know, it didn't happen that way? Of course. I wish it would have been much easier. I wish he would have understood my needs, but he wasn't listening to what I needed.
So it seems like, though, with all of the, I don't want to say just ups and downs, because mm-hmm. it's not even that trite, but mm-hmm. it sounds like with all of the turmoil that mm-hmm. you went through in your relationship with your father, mm-hmm. the positive of it was that you were able to make amends and make peace with each other before his death.
Yes.
Which I think is such an important lesson. Think of how many families, especially now around the holiday times, can mm-hmm. sometimes be at odds with each other.
Yes.
I would think that would be a great message that you would want to send to people, to, you know, family is important. Mm-hmm. And, you know, sometimes we don't always have the best family member. Some people out there, there's a reason why family shouldn't be in their life, but there are other reasons why you do want to make amends with your family. Do you feel like that's a strong message to send to people?
Absolutely. And you have to pick and choose which members of your family are going to be worth that investment, because it's emotionally draining. It's, you know, I can't tell you how many times my dad and I went back and forth. He would drain me. I would try to explain things to him. He would drain me. He wouldn't get it. And so you have to pick and choose what is worth it. To me, it was worth mending the relationship with my dad. He was a dying man and he asked for forgiveness. So of course I'm going to give him forgiveness. Of course I'm going to give him a chance to, you know, say that the words that were so hard for him to say, I'm sorry, I felt like a bad father. And it wasn't even that. Like, there were just decisions that were made, and your hot-headedness and your temper. The temperamental ways are way worse than all the other stuff, because you did try. Like, there were times you really tried to provide for us. I mean, that was his most important thing. He wasn't lazy. He got up. He went to work. All the time, I rarely ever saw him take a day off, even when he was sick, which was very rarely, if I ever saw him sick. He went and did what he had to do as a father, as a provider, as a husband. And it was just his behavior that caused friction between him and my mom, him and me. And he was a lot better with my younger sister, Christina, because we're 8 years apart, and he did not pressure her in anything. So they had a different relationship, because I told him, I said, don't do what you did with me with her. Just let her be a child. Let her grow up and do the things, you know, she wants to do, but also obviously have boundaries. I mean, that's important for kids. But she didn't get the brunt of that because I stepped in and I spoke up and I helped kind of make the path easier for her. But yeah, you got to make amends with people that are worth it. I mean, you don't want people leaving this earth and never having a chance to say, hey, I'm sorry, or we made our peace. And I'm so thankful that, you know, my dad and I did, because he was a big, big factor in my childhood. He was a big male figure in my childhood, not only because he was my dad, but because he believed in my success before I even was born. He believed I would be a champion.
How much of a role does that play, too, do you think, in a parent's role in a child's life? That the parents have to believe, help you believe, that you can be and do anything that you want to do.
It's huge. I think that having that parental support is enormous, because the child is going to have that instilled belief from somebody. Now, some children dig deep and somehow maybe they have a torn relationship in their own family and their family doesn't believe in them. They have to dig even deeper because they are trying to prove something. They want to get out of poverty or whatever it is. They want to prove they can be the best at something, and they're going to work their hearts out. But it all has a common theme: the belief in your ability to do it, whether someone's believing in you, a coach has to believe in you, a parent has to believe in you, and you have to ultimately believe in yourself. Now, I feel you have a leg up in the game if you have that parental support that's going to be pushing you in that right direction. You have a little bit extra because of that, you know, and it guides you in the right way. But I think it plays such a good and positive role, especially when you have to dedicate so much of your life. You need a balance. You need that balance in life and with your family when you are devoted so much to a dream and a goal, because the entire family sacrifices when you think about it. They sacrifice time with you because you're at the gym 4 to 8 hours a day when you start reaching your peak, you know, performance and your peak competition years. You're spending a lot of time away from them, and you know, you want to make sure that it's worth it for you. You want to leave the sport or whatever you choose to do that you're passionate about, knowing that, you know, you loved it, you gave it all you got. Is it going to be fun every single day? No, that's like not reality. There's going to be days you have to push yourself when you don't want to push yourself. And that's what people have to understand. It's a lot more of those days to accomplish your dreams than the easy and good days.
When you look back on some of the video of your competition, and you see this young pint-sized girl who nails everything perfectly. And sure, you have those moments when you fall and you go, oh, ouch, right? Which I don't think I can even get one foot on the balance beam. I don't know what you were doing on the balance beam. What do you think when you watch that little girl?
Well, I look at that little girl through a different pair of eyes. Obviously, my adult and mother eyes now. But I see someone that I can't believe she went through all that she did and came out a survivor. And so many people didn't even have a clue that I was going through all of that. And the fact that I could hide that so well for a child, I look back and I'm like, how did I do that? Like, you know, it's very difficult to hide those things when you're out performing.
And meaning the, like, not able to eat. You were being pushed and to the point of performing on fractures.
Right.
You were, in essence, being tortured by your coaches.
There was abuse going on. There's no doubt about it. You know, abuse is a topic that has come into, you know, light of the media recently.
Yeah, I know. There have been a lot of stories about that. I would imagine, I mean, you were one of, among the first to write about it, especially because you had a celebrity. You know, your name holds a lot of weight. And you were one of the more well-known gymnasts to come forward and say there are some things that aren't quite right going on in the world of USA Gymnastics, especially with Bella and Marta Caroli.
Right.
And you took a lot of heat for it. And now what has come to light, even separate from them, although it seems as though they had knowledge of it, allegedly, and haven't, and didn't do anything about it, but that there were abuse cases, physical abuse, sexual abuse of some young female gymnasts. Where are you on that?
You know, I mean, it's certainly a topic of concern. I've been shouting it from the rooftops for a while now. a lot of people believe me. They knew because they contacted me and emailed me and said, look, we believe you. We know there's things going on. We're so happy that you're saying something about it. But again, there's going to be those non-believers and people who they always want proof. And, you know, but first you gotta show that there's a serious problem going on here that we need to make sure that we're addressing and looking into. But the unfortunate part is anyone that's ever spoken out against USA Gymnastics is never contacted again to be asked, hey, how can we make it better? So they just kind of push you out of the scenario entirely, and they never contact you again, and they look at you as like a bad person. Mm-hmm. And that's how they try to depict you to everybody. And that's such a complete false narrative.
Yeah.
When you're trying to do something good, if I had known somebody, let's say I was running an organization, and somebody came out with a book like I did, I would contact them immediately. I would not want that as a representation of our highest achievers in our sport that are saying this happened. But when you're biased as the president and you're covering up for those coaches because you've already chosen a side, you haven't given an opportunity to look at it with a fresh set of eyes, an unbiased pair of eyes. You just say, oh, that person's bad, they're out to get something, when in reality, I wasn't out to get anything. I was out to speak the truth in hopes of making it better so other athletes aren't harmed. And that is a very, very real scenario nowadays. You're looking at what's happening with, you know, a physician that was with USA Gymnastics for all these years. There are serious allegations going on right now. And I've had victims contact me, and I will not, you know, talk about that because they've entrusted me with
that
information.
For sure, that's very private.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. But this stuff happened, and it happened at the Caroli Ranch. It happened on property of USA Gymnastics where they hold national team training camps. That should be a serious concern, and certain changes have to be implemented. And I have heard that, you know, staff members are no longer allowed to go in the cabins of the gymnasts at the camps, and there have been some changes, but never once has the president contacted athletes like me and athletes from the past to be like, hey, let's make it better. Instead, they shut us out. If you don't want to hear our voices, how are you going to make it better? People who have actually been there, done that. You can't just listen to the people that will tell you what you want to hear. It's not going to work out well that way.
So is your feeling that it's about protecting an image? Like, I remember the first time that you and I met, and we ended up having an in-depth conversation about gymnastics in your past life. And when I watched you as a young girl perform in the Olympic Games, and Bella Caroli would pick you up and hug you, I thought, oh my gosh, she's like her grandpa, right?
Right.
So when we spoke and I found out that he was not necessarily the sweet and loving grandfatherly figure that I grew up thinking he was, then my image of him changed. But I knew the core of you, I knew the depth of you, and I knew you were speaking the truth. There are others who don't know you.
Right.
Right? And so that image, they don't want that image to become disfigured.
Of course not.
So do you think that that has been a huge battle that you've been up against in terms of, oh, here comes this young woman and she's smashing the image?
Of course. I mean, this current, you know, president of USA Gymnastics and the past president of USA Gymnastics have all protected that image. They have not listened to the young athletes and the young women that are speaking up, and now they're forced to because there's lawsuits pending, there's alleged abuse situations going on. These are serious. These were, you know, little girls that were harmed, young prepubescent teenagers. And we have to look at this very, very carefully. I mean, it's a serious concern. And right now, it's still
image
pending.
Doesn't matter anymore. It shouldn't matter.
It can't. I mean, what about the image of those poor kids' lives? What about them going into adulthood and being scarred?
Right.
I mean, we could have prevented this more even longer ago.
For sure.
If we worked together instead of protecting the all powers that be and giving them near 100% autonomy.
Right.
And networks hiring them over and over and making them the center attention of the broadcasts every time gymnastics on. Why were they doing that?
Do you speak with this with great passion, and you have for a long time, And there are those who go, thank you. Mm-hmm. And there are those who then criticize you for it. But your voice has remained unwavered through the entire process. Mm-hmm. Do you feel like this is now a cause you'll continue to champion and you will continue to stay strong and be passionate and aggressive, even if you have to be?
I will always have this as a passionate topic in my life, no matter what stage of life I'm in, because the protection of our children and our young boys and girls in our sports should be the number one priority. Always. You know, we want that for our children. We never want them harmed. We don't want them harmed in sports either. You bring them to sports to build self-esteem. But when there's this, you know, secret that's going on, and these girls, I'm seeing them as adult women. They are, I mean, they are a shell of themselves. I mean, they cannot overcome what has happened to them. I'm talking to girls who've confided in me, and they're like, this explains so much of why I am the way I am now, or why I can't deal with certain things. The trauma, they never were fully allowed to deal with it. They kept it hidden. They kept it secret. And that's a scary place to be. Yes, for nearly 15, 20 years.
Right, to not be able to speak your truth.
Yes.
And to fear the truth.
And you're trapped because you know that these people are so powerful that they'll come and try to attack you for maybe it not being true, or you're altering what you remember. They blame it on you sometimes. Oh, this is, you know, she's maybe fabricating or making things up. And I'm like, what are you talking about? Like, you know, you don't make stuff up like that.
Right.
And details. I mean, I know girls that came to me that told me details. And that is why I've been such a firm believer from the get-go of all these stories that were coming out. Now, obviously, you have to question, you have to make sure that it's legitimate. Absolutely, you have to, because you can't falsely accuse people. I'm not for that either. You have to make sure that when you come out, you are ready. It's a process. You know, I remember one of the girls that I was talking with, she was so scared to talk about it, but she's found healing now. Little by little, she's finding healing.
How soon after the abuse did she come to you? Or did she live with it for
years? Oh, she kept it in. No, almost 20 years till she told me, and, you know, and I see her on occasion. But it's just, like, unbelievable to me that stronger, systematic, like, enforcements aren't in place. Like,
what do you think needs to happen then moving forward?
Well, there's a lot moving forward. We have to see what comes of these pending lawsuits that are, because there's a lot of depositions that are being, they're being sealed right now, but people are appealing to get them with FOIA, the Freedom of Information Act, and other things. But I think that when that comes out, it'll be interesting because the media will go ahead and dissect what's in those depositions. Mm-hmm. There's those current pending lawsuits, but there's also, you know, the Team USA physician that has been now part of all of this for, he was physician for almost 30 years.
Right.
And had such trust. Mm-hmm. So many people.
Did you know this physician?
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. I knew him very well. And he did. He used to sneak people food. He snuck us food and befriended us and was our best buddy.
So you liked him when you were younger?
We didn't know any better. Mm-hmm. He was the only person around. It wasn't, you know, there were some trainers, but he was the doctor that you would go to. And everyone that I talked to cannot believe it, because it's the person who gained the trust and was always with the little girls and always had trust with the families and, you know, all of this. So a lot of people, you know, were texting me and asking me questions and
wondering if it happened to you, right, I'm sure.
Of course. And it did not happen to me. So, you know, I can speak that with 100% certainty. Mm-hmm. But all of these stories started to have a lot of similarities. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when women, you know, they're credible. You know, people that come to you that are crying on the phone and saying, I don't know what to do. You know, thank you for helping me and all of that. I mean, that's where I'm behind the scenes and I feel like I'm helping them move forward from their pain. They're crying, they're emotional, they're just like, you know, thanks Stomp for helping me. She's like, you know,
they want someone to believe them too.
Yes.
Right? When you're abused in any way, you just want someone to believe you, especially when you fear coming forward.
Yeah, I mean, it's who wants to come forward with this kind of thing when you think about it?
Right.
It's not fun, it's not glamorous, and you're not doing it for attention. So people who are trolling the internet and saying, oh, they're doing it for attention. No, why do you think all of them have hidden names in the lawsuits? They all have a Jane Doe, because they are scared to really come forward. And many people in our community will not talk about this. There were, I mean, so many people who even are trying to interview me, and I said, look, this is for the victims. I want them to get confidence. This is about them. Mm-hmm. And let them gain their confidence and strength. I wasn't personally affected, but I have insight from all my years. I was one of the people to speak out about this topic. But, you know, when you're going into other forms of abuse, right, it goes even deeper. And, you know, I wasn't affected by those things, but I support the women if they want to come forward. You know, I've given people information to go to who they need to talk to if they want to talk to someone to get help. But, you know, that just the fact that they confided in me, I know that I'm doing the right thing. And I always have. I have, like you said, I've never wavered on this. And it would be very easy to, because they try to make you the bad guy. Again, the organization tries to make you the bad guy. And there are good people in the organization. That's the thing. I have a couple of people in there that I think are very nice that I know. And it's not their fault, but it's from the leadership down. And if the leadership sets a tone, they have to follow. And they may not agree with it. They may not choose to do it that way, but they just have to follow orders. But I think right now they're definitely trying to make some adjustments and changes. Now, I don't know what all those things are right now, but this is far from over.
There's a lot of heaviness in your life with gymnastics. And I know you love the sport. Yes. It's your favorite sport, let's say, right?
Yes.
That and Ohio State football?
Of course. Go Bucks.
Go Bucks.
Yeah, what a weekend.
I know. It's been great. Yeah. Yes, I know. Very good. We like where we're sitting.
Yes.
But obviously the topic of gymnastics and these heavy topics, they come into your world and people want to talk to you about them. Does it ever start to feel a little too heavy to you? Do you feel like sometimes you just want to break from it? Because that's not the only thing that defines you. There are you have so many other interests and so many other aspects of your life. Does it sometimes get a little tiring?
You know, I take care of this topic with great sense of duty. I feel that I have gotten to a place where I want these women who have been harmed in one way or another by abuse, by any kind of abuse, to get to a place where they can believe that they can live a happy, healthy life. Mm-hmm. That to me is so powerful, because you're personally helping impact another's life, that they're coming out of this dark, deep hole that they have been in a place where they haven't been able to talk to their family members. I know one of my friends had contacted me and she was like, you know, I'm finally dealing with this. She's like, I've gone to therapists for all these years and I'm finally truly dealing with this. And she hadn't even told her therapist that this happened. And so you can imagine how deep, if even in a safe place, you feel like you can't tell them. This goes deep, deep, deep in many layers.
Right.
And the fact that she's like, you're helping me and my family deal with this. She's like, I talked to my family for the first time and all these things. And, you know, I guided her and, you know, just some steps, said, here's what you could probably do. It's your choice when you're ready. You know, but I really feel like it's important for you to move on with your life. You have to open this chapter and deal with it, as painful as it is, but you can put it behind you and you can live a good life. You can do this. You can overcome this. Don't feel like your life is over, you know, because people feel like they're tainted and they're damaged goods. You don't want to wear that label around your life, like I'm damaged goods. And I would refuse that too, because I've been hurt so many times with so many people. I've been, you know,
and trying to put labels on you. You've had labels put on you before, right?
I have.
And so what do you do? What's your advice to people who have those labels and sometimes aren't always positive labels?
Right.
How have you learned to reject them?
I don't believe them. They're not me. Mm-hmm. They're not me. And anyone who puts a false narrative or a false label on me is completely out of line and ridiculous. I'm like, I even laugh at it now because I'm like, you don't even know me.
Right. Because what are things that people have said? What are some of the real doozies?
She's trying to, you know, speak out to get attention.
Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. Okay.
Right.
Yeah, exactly.
Because you need that.
Exactly. I'm like, no, I'm speaking out because it's the truth and I needed to heal and I needed to talk about these things because we can make the future better. People don't understand. If you've never been in that situation, it's easy for you to be like, oh, you know, throw something negative or nasty at that person. But really, what are you accomplishing by doing that? You're just being a bad person.
No, it doesn't help the conversation
at
all.
No, mm-hmm. It's like you don't even want it to start. You're like, oh, it didn't happen. I don't believe it. I'm like, well, you don't even want to help the situation because you have to have a dialogue for it to get better and improve. And you have to discuss this because it's real life. You can't just shut that person out completely. Nothing gets done by doing that.
Right.
So I just kind of reject the labels. And it's hard sometimes, you know, social media. Sometimes
which
I'm
is
not
a
afraid.
Completely different thing right now, too, right?
Yes.
So when you were a young gymnast, you didn't have to worry about social media.
No, it's completely different.
Right.
Now.
There were tabloid magazines still,
right.
Which could be annoying sometimes. Mm-hmm. But certainly with social media now, and people can write anything they want, that's a challenge. And I know that you're very active in social media.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Sometimes I'm not afraid to let people know, like, look, you are out of line. Like, don't be a hater. Why are you going to say something you don't even know anything about? When this topic of abuse came up, and, you know, I asked people what their thoughts were, and some people were obviously very supportive, mostly, but then there's a couple of trolls on there.
But don't you find that if you call someone out on something
negative
that they say,
they delete everything, and I'm
like, okay. Right, because people come to your rescue then, too.
People speak up because you're out of line. Like, if you're out of line, sometimes I'll ignore it, and I'm like, it's not worth it. But then there are other times where I'm like, you know what? No, you are not going to do that, and that is not okay.
Yeah.
And I'm going to show people what you said, and you know what? You got to deal with it.
Give
and
it back a little bit.
Yeah, I'm a fighter. I'm a fighter.
You are.
I've always had to fight for things.
The Romanian in you, right?
Yeah, hot-bloodedness.
Yeah, right?
But in a good way. But yeah, I mean, that, you know, European in me comes out. But I'm not afraid to stick up for myself. And I think that's the thing we fall into a trap of sometimes. It's like, oh, we're not allowed to defend ourselves. I'm like, wait a second. Why? You just let someone walk all over you, say all these things about you, and you can't speak up for yourself? And I understand the thought process of, don't get into every little battle. And I don't. But every now and then, I'll be like, you know what? Enough is enough.
Yeah.
And then that person ended up deleting everything. And I'm like, see, you weren't that confident about what you said because you took back everything as soon as you got a little bit of heat about it.
Right.
Imagine being in someone else's shoes that gets a lot more heat than just some people, you know, calling you out. I mean, you have to have some tough skin in this world and thick skin because you're not, you know, people aren't going to always love everything you say or do, but if you're doing things in the right way and for the right cause and for the right meaning, you know, things will work out in the long run. Sometimes you have to go through some hardships to get there. But I feel like, you know, things are in a good place for me right now.
Well, I also think that what's great for a lot of your fans with social media is that they can sort of either live vicariously through you or get a sneak peek into the window of your life. Like,
Right. Like
often we'll see you. I know you and your husband, Mike, also love UFC.
Yes.
So you do. You've gone to a couple of fights.
Yeah.
And you have loved UFC even as it was just like starting to become popular. It's like, I think with Stipe,
our
local
definitely
guy
here.
Winning, now we all know what it is. Yeah. I know. I remember my mom saying to me, are you ever going to interview Miocic? And I was like, she calls him by his last name, which
that's
I think
funny.
Is funny. So yeah, so I think in the Cleveland area, certainly now,
well,
there are a lot of us
who love
it.
He started, he was the first world champion that came, brought it back to Cleveland this year. And then it was the Cavs and then Lake Erie Monsters. And so it was just, it was a ripple effect. But he started that and he broke the curse. So in a way, he is like a hometown hero for sports.
For sure. But you love UFC, right?
Yeah, totally.
Do you have some favorites?
Oh, yeah. I mean, one of my all-time favorites is George St. Pierre, GSP. He's not competing anymore, but totally always loved watching him. Obviously, Conor McGregor is always, you know, he is one of those you love or you hate.
Yeah.
But his persona and his ability to back it up is really pretty incredible. A lot of people clown on him because he has this you know, this persona larger than life. And mm-hmm. but in a way, it's part theater. It's part selling stuff. It's part, you know, selling tickets to. So you have to understand that part of that persona is intentional. But obviously, Ronda Rousey, she's making her comeback in December. She took a little bit of time off to recover from some injuries. So she's always been very interesting to me from a female perspective. I love a girl who can kick some butt.
Yeah, for
so
sure.
So I'm all about that. Uh-huh. And let's see who else. There's
and
a
she's
lot of
really
good ones.
Been a, literally a fighter, right? Because
yeah.
she, we weren't expecting her to lose her
yes.
big fight, and that was tough on her.
Of course,
I
it
remember
was.
Her being on Ellen. And really, she was very tearful.
Oh, yeah.
It was an emotional interview, but I found it impressive that she could be that vulnerable and honest about, you know, you think somebody who's that tough can't feel broken inside.
Oh, no.
And she did.
She oh, yeah.
And I think that's important
so
to talk about.
Yeah.
Right?
There's so much pressure, you know. Mm-hmm. You want to be the best, and you're fighting to be the best, and you have this huge, you know, PR pushing that, you know, that narrative, and also her backing it up time and time again. Mm-hmm. And then she has a huge knockout that defeats her. And she literally feels like she wants to give up on life because she's
yeah.
so broken.
Right.
And you do, like, when you work so hard, and athletes are like this, among the most emotional people I know, mm-hmm. because you give so much of your heart and your training. Every day you are beating yourself up to become better and become your best. And a lot of people don't know what that's like. You push yourself to the brink of not being able to do it.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how you become the best. There's no key. It's all hard, hard, hard work.
What do you think are the greatest gifts? Like, in short, what do you think are the greatest gifts that you learned from becoming an athlete, a top performing athlete?
Never give up. You never know when you're closer than you think. Just at that time where you feel like you want to give up, there will be an unexpected open door. But it's always, you got to push a little harder. It's like that depiction with that, you know, guy chipping away at, like, I don't know if you've seen this, but it's like chipping away at, like, this basically mud. And uh-huh. and there's the jewels are, like, on the other side, but he's like a sliver this way. On top, there's a depiction of a man walking away, uh-huh. and he's this close, and the other one on the bottom is still chipping away. And you're never, you know, you always feel like right before you're going to accomplish that victory, like right before the Olympics, for me, it was like, oh my God, I can't wait for this to be over, in a way, because the training yeah. was so much, and yeah. I was so tired, and my body and my mind and my spirit were like run down. And I was like, I got to do this, though. I got to keep going,
right.
because I worked so hard for this. And so you play a mind game, and you try to motivate yourself. So never give up, because you're always closer than you think to that goal. It may take longer. Like, I had recently, I would say, an 18-year goal that came to life. That's a long time to wait.
Yeah, nothing. It's not an overnight success.
It's never. No.
No.
And Mike and I, uh-huh. you know, my husband Mike and I always say, it becomes it's 10 years to become an overnight success. You
yeah.
cannot become one overnight.
Yeah.
It's always 10 years. When you think
yeah.
someone came out of the blue and achieved success, it usually they were working on it for years and years and years before you saw them in the mainstream
right.
or something, you know?
Right.
So I always say, never ever give up. You're always closer than you think. And that's something I learned in gymnastics, because I had to push myself to these goals. And the competitions
yeah.
weren't always, you know, overnight. They were, you had to take steps to get there, and each step made you get closer to the next step, and ultimately, obviously, the Olympic goal. And so that was one thing. The next thing I would say is always believe in yourself, even when the critics don't. I mean, you see
the critics.
That
can be hard.
Yeah.
That can be hard, right?
Yeah. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
because, you know, sometimes you feel like you're, like, all out there all alone.
Mm-hmm.
But in the end, you have to live your dream for you. You have to do what's right for you and make sure that, you know, you're living your true self. You don't need to please someone or change who you are. Because then you become a miserable person. You become unhappy.
How much did writing your book, Off Balance, teach you about yourself? Did you learn new things about yourself in that process of writing a book?
I definitely learned a lot about myself. I definitely learned a lot of... Oh, my neighbor.
Okay.
yeah, I didn't
just
know if he wanted...
Just
speaking in. I didn't know if he wanted something or what. But, yeah, I learned a lot about myself writing the book. I learned that I could allow myself to be vulnerable when I thought, I don't know how I can. I pushed myself to be so honest and so raw that I felt good about it. Sometimes it's hard to get to those places, as you know.
Well, you challenged me to do the same when I wrote. So I know it's very healing.
It's very healing. So I learned that I could heal. That was a big step in writing my book. It was like, I had these things inside my heart and I needed to heal so badly. I needed to find a way to be beyond that. And also clear up a misconception of what people thought they knew about me. It was, and it wasn't really out, that was like a sidebar. It was an additional plus. It wasn't the main reason for it, but I wanted people to know the truth from my words, from my vantage point, how it actually happened. Right. Then you can make your assessment after reading the book. But everybody that's, you know, contacting me after reading, they're like, wow, I didn't know you went through all those things.
For sure. It's coming from your voice. Yes. Which then literally you had it come from your voice when you recorded the audio version of Off Balance.
Oh, there were times I got lump in my throat even reading it. You know, no matter how many times I've talked about my dad and I've come out, that was the hardest part for me to talk about. Mm-hmm. It was the most deep cuts that I had. That I had to talk about, and I literally get choked up when I talk about my dad still because of that relationship we had, that give and take, that tug and pull. And in the end, you know, he's never gonna see my grandkids or his grandkids. He's never gonna see my children grow up, you know, and all of that. And so it's just, it's a very emotional thing. I mean, imagine if you lost your father very early on with a rare cancer that, you know, you made peace, but you had this tumultuous relationship and you just always wanted better and wanted better for him to be able to, you know that he was loved, but I challenged him. He challenged me, you know, and so it was an interesting relationship.
And that's where faith comes into play, right? That you hope in a different way. He's seeing and watching them.
He's for sure seeing and watching them. But the crazy thing is, I know he would have been such a great grandfather.
Yes.
He would have been so fun. He would have been so fun. Just play alone, give him back. I mean, he would have been so different.
And at ease with himself at that point.
Yes.
Yeah, no pressure.
He would have been trying to impress anybody.
Right.
He would just be him. And when he's like that, it's good. But I think pressure got to him too. Like when I look back, pressure got to him too, of financially supporting our, you know, the sport that I did and the bills. And it wasn't like my parents were wealthy. My parents came from very modest beginnings. I mean, he came here with like $15 in his pocket. My mom slept in a car when she was pregnant with me in Hollywood, you know, California.
Isn't that unbelievable to think of that?
I think of that and I'm like, how lucky am I that you guys made that step to move here? You know, she was pregnant with me, didn't speak a lick of English, was terrified to be in this country all alone, left her parents, who she basically never left, and her, you know, her brother and his wife, who she stayed with in her high school years in Romania. I mean, she left to a whole new land. Everything was foreign to her.
Right.
And it was scary. And she's like basically married someone she doesn't even really know in an arranged marriage on top of all that. Could you imagine?
No, talk about going out of your comfort zone.
Yeah.
Like you have no warm blanket, right?
No.
Yes. That, no protection at all. So that
always fascinated me.
That's very brave.
Yes. And that's the thing I always, you know, remind my mom. I was like, Mom, you know, I think what you guys did was amazing. You gave us a better life. And I don't ever want you to feel bad about, you know, but she carries things very heavy, as parents do. You know, they tried their best. And I always tell her, like, you did a great job. You were always very compassionate and very, you know, just very wanted the best. And
I'm sure that that's important to hear for parents from their children. You did a great job.
Yeah.
You did a great job.
And I said, given your circumstances, you couldn't do any more. And I appreciate that. You guys helped me achieve a goal. Was it exactly how I intended for it to be? No. Was it hard on me? Yeah. But are we in a good place now? Sure. It's because we're willing to move forward. We're willing to accept that this happened. We acknowledge it. I had my way of healing. You have yours. Like for me, it was through a book. That wasn't your ideal way for me to heal. You did not like that.
Right.
But I had to make my own big girl decisions.
Mm-hmm.
And it was hard on you when I wrote my book. And I know that. But I never once put you in a situation where I was very honest about who you were, and you were a good person. And so I just wanted her to know that. You know, one day she'll gain the confidence to read it, but she's never.
She hasn't read it.
No.
She's not ready.
Yeah, she's
when
not
she's
ready.
Ready.
Yeah, and you know, I never push it. I never force it. I think it's too much for her to bear sometimes to read all the things your daughter went through that you didn't even know.
Right.
See, she didn't even know a lot of this stuff was going on. I never told her. because they had enough problems in the house and we had enough stress as it was. I just kept to myself. Right. And I told my Aunt Janice, because she was one I could have hide in, and she also was very Americanized, so she was like all for supporting, you know, and giving me the best childhood I could have. On top of it, my parents had asked her to kind of basically be our extended family, and she was like, yeah, she loves kids, you know. And she's the one who stood up for me in a lot of situations with my dad. She's like, I almost got in a fist fight with your dad several times. But she's like, I had brothers. I was not afraid. So, but it was good to have someone like that around who wasn't afraid of authority, like authority figures like the Carollis. And, you know, she got into it with Marta once, too. And she's like, I'm not afraid of her. So just the fact that there was that person that wasn't afraid of them,
yes,
you know, was good, because it taught me, like, you don't have to fear these people. You know, you do what's right. What's right is what matters.
Oh, we Americans, we're not afraid to say what we think, right?
Yeah, and my parents coming from communism, you couldn't say what you thought.
Right.
You were silenced.
Mm-hmm.
And even with the secret police, like, you know, they knew immediately if somebody got out of line and somehow it got back to them. I mean, they're showing up at your front door. Right.
So that was programmed into them.
It was programmed. Mm-hmm. You don't say, and even in our culture, you don't speak up. You don't say. So that was like a really hard thing for my mom when I started speaking up. She's like, why are you always the one getting the arrows? You know, they're going to paint you in a bad light for speaking up. They're going to make you be the bad guy. I'm like, Mom, no. I said, it's not right. I said,
it's called freedom.
Yeah.
Isn't that a beautiful thing, right? We're so lucky.
Yeah, we're very lucky. We're very lucky.
So totally switching gears, by the way, do you notice my necklace?
I noticed your necklace. The Andrea. Oh, the Andrea. Awesome. I love it.
So that is one of the really cool things that I love that you ended up doing on the other side of your career. Obviously, always known for gymnastics.
Right.
You know, you're a mother of two children, but you always had it in you to still want to be a businesswoman.
Yes.
And so I think it's really cool that one of your dreams was to start a jewelry company, and you did it.
You did it.
Yeah. You had this stick-to-itiveness. Mm-hmm. You're like, I'm going to learn how to do it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to make this happen.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember the first time sitting around your kitchen table and, like, deciding what I wanted my necklace to look like, which I love and is, like, such a precious item. But that's been a really exciting part of your life and your
career,
too.
Yeah, for sure.
Creations by CNC.
Yes, yes. Very proud of it. You know, our custom designs are awesome, and the great thing about it is you get, you know, a personal touch. You get to interact with us, and we can design your custom vision if you want, make it come to life.
Yeah.
We have a lot of fun stuff for the holidays, and yes, I always wanted to put that business degree to use. My mom told me, you should do something. You're so good with business. And
she
always believed in me, and she always loved jewelry, and so it kind of just started, like, when I was young, my sister and I are like, so who are you putting in the will, like, that ring? I want that ring. She wants that. So it was just
what,
like,
is it about
so,
kids doing that? They're, like, claiming their mother's jewelry,
I know.
Right?
It's so funny. And my sister and I are, like, arguing about which ring we want. I said, no, I want to get that ring. I get the anniversary ring. She's like, well, I want that one. And it was so funny how we were drawn to my mom's, you know, jewelry. And we didn't have a lot of money, but she always got, like, the bargain amazing. She's like, everyone thinks it's all real, and, you know, some of it is, but some of it's not. And she's like, I always get compliments on my jewelry. And it was so funny because she did, I mean, always stop when there was a jewelry store. Like, I'd lose her in the mall because I'm like, Mom, okay. I'm like, I gotta go because you're gonna be here for the next hour. And she'd always look for the best deal.
And the more the better, right?
Yeah.
Did she wear a lot of it?
Sometimes she'd stack them, and, you know, I mean, she could never have enough crosses because she's full of faith. And so I always laugh at them, like, Mom, you really need another one? And I was like, but it was just funny because that's what she liked. And so then I developed my own taste and my own things that I liked and things that I, you know, developed my own style. And then eventually, it was really awesome. I just really enjoy having a creative outlet where it's something different from gymnastics, but I can put all of my work ethic and my skills that I used in training, I can use that in business. You know, dedication, hard work, you know, staying on top of the goals and things like that, that all transfer over into everyday life. So, and I'd be remiss if I didn't mention my business partner, Wendy Campbell. She's awesome, a gym mom, and
you know,
shared my vision.
Well, you said share your vision, but what's great is that you're very yin and yang, I think.
Yes.
Which has worked well. It's not easy to have a business partner,
right.
A,
Right.
Be then somebody who you're not related to and right. you work well together because yes. you know what can happen. Everyone can have yeah. a different vision.
Oh,
so
for
the
sure.
fact that you can have a similar vision, maybe some different ideas and yes. make it work is really cool. You're very lucky actually, don't you think, to
have
found a business partner who you work well with?
Yes, and that's the thing, you know, Wendy understands my life. She understands who I am in the sense of like as a person, not like the fame part, but she understands that side of me too, but she understands who I am as a person. She understands like, you know, what strengths I bring. I understand her strengths and we, you know, feed off of each other. And she has a very creative mind and I really appreciate her input. I appreciate her dedication, her hard work. I mean, she's a hard worker and you can't really be around me in this kind of a business setting if you don't know how to work hard, because I expect as much as I give in. And it's hard to give in as much as I put in. Uh-huh. But she gets that. She's like, man, I thought I had my stuff together. She's like, oh my gosh, you know? She's like, keeping up with you is tough sometimes. But
I think that's the great thing about you. I think you challenge people to be even better and to up their game. I think that's a really cool part about being in your world.
Aw, thank you.
Mm-hmm. So I'm so proud of you. I want to thank you for doing Driving Cleveland, because I think it's so cool. So many people who know of you and are fans are like, wait a minute, she's from Cleveland? I go, she's not from Cleveland, but she lives in Cleveland now with her family and has made it her home. And I know you love the city.
Yes.
You root for the city.
Yeah.
And you, again, like I said, you've made it your home. So I'm just really proud of all that you've done, and thank you for being here and for doing this and taking the ride and sharing your story, because it's a really cool one.